Welcome to the Patient Pulse. Today we welcome Dr. Aaron Aday, who is joining us to discuss the basics of polyvascular disease, both what it means and why it's something on our radar at NATF. Dr. Aday is a cardiologist and vascular medicine specialist at Vanderbilt University Medical Center in Nashville, Tennessee. He's also a vascular medicine advisor on NATF's Medical Advisory Board. His research interests largely focus on the prevention, diagnosis, and management of peripheral artery disease. So welcome, Dr. Aday. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Great. Thank you so much for the invitation and the opportunity to speak. As you heard, we're going to focus on polyvascular disease and really help patients understand what they need to know about this disease. And just for a quick overview of the topic, again, we're going to define polyvascular disease. We're going to talk about how this affects your health, talk about how you tell if you have polyvascular disease as a patient, and then, of course, cover some of the treatments available for patients with polyvascular disease. So when we talk about polyvascular disease, we're talking about atherosclerosis in your arteries, and we'll define that a little bit more. Now, atherosclerosis can affect pretty much any artery in your body, but we typically focus on three main categories of atherosclerosis. One being carotid artery stenosis. This is cholesterol and atherosclerosis buildup in the arteries in your neck that feed your brain. Here you can see a CAT scan and a pretty large blockage here in this artery. We also think about peripheral artery disease, and this is atherosclerosis in the arteries of your leg. You see it built up here. And then, of course, coronary artery disease. And this is, again, atherosclerosis in the arteries feeding your heart muscle itself. And collectively, atherosclerosis in these three main areas, this still remains the leading cause of death in the U.S. and in the world. Now, traditionally, again, we focus kind of on each category on its own. Now we use this framework of polyvascular disease, and this is atherosclerosis in two or three of these beds. This can be any combination, so carotid artery stenosis plus coronary artery disease, peripheral artery disease plus coronary artery disease, or all three. And again, we typically, when we use this term, we mean that patients have symptoms related to this atherosclerosis, not just that there's some atherosclerosis lining the artery, but not causing any issues. So patients who've had a prior heart attack plus issues related to atherosclerosis in the legs, they've had a prior stroke, those kinds of things. And this is not a rare phenomenon. So this is a study of around 70,000 patients, the majority of whom had some sort of atherosclerosis. And you can see here that around 16% or 11,000 of these patients had polyvascular disease. And here you have the breakdown. You can see patients with coronary artery disease plus the carotid artery disease, coronary plus leg. And again, I'll point out that here we have around 1.6% or over 1,000 of these patients had symptomatic disease in all three of these major artery beds. So again, this is not a rare phenomenon. Now we mentioned that this is atherosclerosis. Just briefly, what does that even mean? This is a process that happens in many of us, if not most of us, over our lifetime. And this is when things like cholesterol and cells that play a role in our immune system travel from the blood into the wall of the blood vessels themselves. Over time, this builds up, inflammation plays a role, and it can lead to these plaques or blockages in our arteries. And just to show what this looks like, here you can see this atherosclerosis that's built up in this artery wall. It can make the artery itself more narrow, so blood flow has trouble going through it. Or in some cases, the lining over this atherosclerosis can fracture, and this causes a blood clot to develop. So again, emphasizing that thrombosis plays a key role in all the different types of polyvascular disease. Now, how does this affect your health? Well, we know that having any one component of polyvascular disease has consequences for your health. So for instance, those patients who have cholesterol or atherosclerosis buildup in their carotid arteries are at risk of transient ischemic attack or stroke and vascular dementia. Those who have coronary artery disease are at risk for myocardial infarction or heart attack, sudden death and heart failure. And those with atherosclerosis in their legs can develop claudication, which is pain in the legs when walking. They can develop pain even at rest in severe cases, ulcers, and they may have to have amputations. But overall, when you have polyvascular disease, when you have two or more of these, it essentially amplifies your risk. And patients with polyvascular disease are at much higher risk of the big major things: heart attack, stroke, amputation, and death. Now, how might your doctor go about determining if you have polyvascular disease? Well, one is just taking a patient history. You want to know if the patient's having a history of chest pain, if they have transient episodes of blurry vision, slurred speech, transient episodes of arm or leg weakness. And then we talked about leg pain when walking. All of those may suggest the patient could have polyvascular disease. The physical exam is important. When we examine patients, we want to check their pulses in different places, in their neck, their arms, and their legs. Again, looking for abnormalities that could suggest polyvascular disease. We listen to the blood vessels. We want to hear if there's abnormal flow, again, suggesting there may be atherosclerosis buildup. And even sometimes we'll check the eye vessels, looking through your pupil, looking at those blood vessels, seeing if there's abnormalities there, which may suggest that there's abnormalities or atherosclerosis in other vessels in your body. And then depending on the patient history and the physical exam, your doctor may recommend additional testing, which can help confirm the diagnosis. These could be ultrasound studies of different arteries. Maybe you would have a stress test. It could be a CAT scan to look at certain arteries, or it could even just measure the blood pressure in your ankles, comparing it to the arms, something called an ankle brachial index. And again, it all depends on the patient and what's been detected during the history and physical exam. How do we treat this? Well, in general, we treat polyvascular disease similarly to the way we treat any individual component of polyvascular disease. So we treat the risk factors for atherosclerosis. We know that smoking is a major risk factor for developing polyvascular disease. And so any patient that is continuing to smoke, we can work very hard with them to figure out strategies that can help them stop. We know that a healthy diet and regular exercise are key components to cardiovascular health. And that's equally important in patients with polyvascular disease. We want to treat high blood pressure and keep it as normal as possible. Intensive cholesterol control is a key therapy for patients with polyvascular disease. Again, because this patient population is higher risk than the average patient with, say, just coronary artery disease or just peripheral artery disease, your doctor may even want to intensify therapy. Say, I want to get your cholesterol as low as possible. Use additional therapies to reduce your risk. This is not the time to hold back. This is the time to really escalate therapy as much as possible. Diabetes is a major driver of polyvascular disease. There are numerous new medications to treat diabetes that are on the market and actually reduce your risk of cardiovascular disease and cardiovascular death. And those are excellent therapies for patients with polyvascular disease and diabetes. And then, of course, we always talk about antiplatelet drugs, things like aspirin and Plavix, and blood thinners, things like warfarin, rivaroxaban, apixaban. You've heard some of these drug names come up before. Now, all of the medications in this last class do have a potential side effect of increased risk of bleeding. And often we talk about the risk and benefit trade-off for each individual patient. I will say that patients with polyvascular disease, since they are at higher risk, often I talk to my patients and say, you know, now may be the time for us to use additional medications to accept some of that increased risk of bleeding because you're in a higher risk category. So I want to emphasize that the treatment is not identical to what we do for patients with any individual component of polyvascular disease. This is a chance to say, look, now you're at higher risk. We need to think about escalating therapy and really doing all we can to help reduce your long-term risk. So just to summarize some of the key points, again, polyvascular disease refers to atherosclerosis and thrombosis in two or more major arteries. We know that patients with polyvascular disease are at greater risk of heart attack, stroke, leg blockages, and death. And patients with polyvascular disease may benefit from more aggressive medications to help reduce this risk. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Aday, and for providing such a great overview of polyvascular disease. We appreciate your time. And thanks to our listeners. Tune in next month for a new episode of Patient Pulse.